there be light. Howdy. I've kind of lived all over, but the place that really captured my heart is Texas. So whenever people ask me where I'm from, I say Texas. I look Texan, don't I? I fit the role. So when I landed here in Calgary, I saw a bunch of people wearing cowboy hats saying howdy. I was like, I know I'm going to love this place. And you guys are a nice people. I'm not sure if you realize this. You are nice. Driving around the streets, I'm seeing some situations where anywhere else it would definitely be horns involved. But here, everyone just lets everyone in. It's very nice. And one thing that I love about this city is that it's extremely international. It's not normal to have Indian food in gas stations. It's not normal. But it's really great to see. Actually, it reminds me very much of Acts chapter 2, when the whole world had gathered in Jerusalem, or so the scripture says, and Peter, after Pentecost, was able to preach the gospel to all these people from all over the world, and they took the gospel back with them where they went. And so the message of the Lord spread because God had put people in the right time and the right place, and I feel like that's what he's done with you here. And so it's amazing to see. It's great to be a privilege to be able to speak into that and be a part of what God is doing here. So let's ask for God to be present now. Let's turn in prayer and see what he does this morning. Lord, we thank you. We're so prone to take for granted the gifts that you've given us. The very fingers that we have, we could never knit together. The fact that we wake up in the morning is not something that we do voluntarily. And Lord, that you've given us this room, this sound system, this lighting, this amazing orchestra to listen to. God, all of these things are gifts from you. And we just pray, Lord, that we would not take it for granted. That we would remember that over half of the world lives on less than $2.50 a day. And that many people, many Christians especially around the world, cannot gather in a room like this without the threat of being killed. And yet they gather all the same. So God, give us confidence. Give us the ability to use these gifts in the way that you intend, not to hoard them up for ourselves, but to use them for others. And Lord, we thank you that during this month of Ramadan, you've given us an opportunity to reach out to our Muslim neighbors and friends and let them know the beauty of the gospel. So please help us, God, reach out to people and pour out what we have for the sake of others. In this time, God, meet us here. I pray that you would be present. Lord, we thank you that when we gather in your name, there shall you also be. We thank you, God, that we know you are in our midst. God, that you have told us that your Holy Spirit resides within us. Thank you, God, that we don't have to chase you, but you chase us. And Lord, I pray that we would have an encounter with you this morning. God, if nobody remembers a single word I say and they only meet with you, that would be far better than anything I could ask for. And so, God, may we have an encounter with you this morning, because when we meet you, we never walk away unchanged. Please come, Holy Spirit. We pray in your name. Amen. So a little bit of background for me. I come from a Muslim family. My father was from Pakistan, so he was the immigrant. I was born in the United States. My dad came in the mid-70s. Actually, he came the day that Elvis died. So when he arrives, he gets off the plane, looks at a newspaper. The newspaper says, the king is dead. And my dad says, I could have sworn they had a democracy. I'm going to have to learn this one over again. And so he comes and learns about the states. And a few years later, he gets married to my mother. It was an arranged marriage. And then my mom, just to give you an idea of who she is the daughter of a Muslim missionary. So my grandfather spent his life preaching Islam in the jungles of Indonesia. and my mom was born in Indonesia, even though she's Pakistani by origin. So that made my grandfather a dai, someone who invited people to Islam. In fact, my mother's grandfather, so now my maternal grandmother's father, he was in Uganda, also preaching Islam, and he was a physician. So he was a missionary, preaching Islam and healing in the name of Allah. And that's where my grandmother was born. So I come from this lineage of Muslim missionaries. And so you can imagine that my mom was very, very devout in her Islamic faith. My dad, 24-year veteran of the U.S. Navy, ultimately, he was a patriot. He retired as a lieutenant commander in the Navy. So I saw him as someone who loved country and loved Islam. And my mom had taught me how to be a good Muslim from a young age. And so all this stuff worked hand in hand for me. To be a good Muslim, by the way, is a lot more than what you might imagine. It really demands your full attention every single day. You live in remembrance of Allah. And just to give you an example of that, when I was in middle school, my mom had taught me, she taught me all kinds of prayers. In fact, when I was 5 years old, my mom had taught me how to read Arabic such that I had read the entire Quran in Arabic by the age of five. And memorized the last seven chapters of the Quran by the age of five, just because my mom was devout, and she impressed that upon me. By the time I got to middle school, much more of the Islamic life had come to fruition. When I'd wake up first thing in the morning, my mom had taught me to recite a prayer. Alhamdulillahilladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa alayhin nushur. Anyone know what that means? Do we have anyone who interprets tongues in this church? What kind of denomination is this? Honestly, I did not know what it meant either. My mom told me to recite it, so I recited it. It was later that I found out what it meant, and this is the prayer. All praise belong to the one who gave me life, causes me to die, and will raise me up again. So every morning, I'm praising God for waking me up, because sleep is a kind of death. How do I know if I'm going to wake up? Thank you, God, for waking me up every morning. But it's also a foreshadow of the day of resurrection, in which Muslims believe that there will be a judgment day. Thank you, God. Every morning we thank God for that. And then after I'd get out of bed, I'd walk towards the washroom. And Muslims attempt to emulate Muhammad as much as they possibly can, because Muhammad is the exemplar. He's the perfect man. And so we try to live like him. And so what we would do is we would walk into the washroom with our left foot first, because that's what Muhammad used to do. Like that degree of detail. And as we go into the washroom, we'd wash our hands and we'd do the ceremonial washing called wudu. And then we'd go to the prayer rugs and pray the first of the five daily prayers called Fajr prayer. And after that, I'd go to the breakfast table. And my mom would say, Nabeel, what do we say before we eat? And I would say, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, in the name of God, the most gracious, the most merciful. And then my mom would give me my food to eat. And when I was done, she would say, now what do we pray? And then so after the food was done, there was a prayer thanking Allah for having made me a Muslim. And she'd send me out the front door saying, Nabeel, don't forget to recite Ayatul Kursi. And this was a long verse from the second chapter of the Quran. And I'd recite that from memory as I'd go to the bus stop. And I'd remember her words to me, which were, Nabeel, before school starts, make sure you recite that prayer that Moses recited in front of the Pharaoh when he was asking God to give him the ability to speak. So the story of Moses is partially found in the Quran as well. And we would use those prayers as archetypal for our own, and we'd memorize them and recite them. That's what it meant to be. Before 7 o'clock in the morning, I had done all that as part of a devout Muslim life. That's what it meant to be Muslim. But at the same time, my mom had presuppositions about the West. When she came here from Pakistan, she had been told in her childhood that America is a Western nation, it's a Christian nation, but look at all the promiscuity, look at the divorces, look at the way people dress on beaches, look at what you see on TV. This is all a result of the fact that it is a Christian nation. And so my mom came with these presuppositions and notions. Now, if anyone, any Christian, had invited her into their home, perhaps she would have realized, wait a minute, I was wrong about all this. Christianity is not that. But no one did. So for over 35 years, nobody from a Christian background invited my mom into their home. So she just perpetuated in these false notions of what Christianity is. And of course, if that's what you think Christianity is going to be like, you're going to protect your Muslim children from Christianity. You're going to give them a defense for their Islamic faith and also something to share with people who might be trying to convert them to Christianity. So what that looked like for me, I'll give you an example. For my junior year of high school, there was a girl in our class. Her name is Betsy. And she was kind of the token Christian. I mean, we knew that because she would tell everyone she's Christian, but also because she was always smiling. And it was rather annoying. It's like, why are you always smiling? Knock it off. She was the token Christian. So one day in class, she turned around. The teacher had walked out. We had a few minutes. She turned around. She said, Nabeel, do you know Jesus? Now, when she asked that question, immediately my respect for her went up. Because I thought, here is someone who believes her faith. See, I knew that Christians believed that if I didn't know Jesus, I was going to go to hell. But why didn't anyone share the gospel with me then? I thought one of two things. If you as a Christian did not share the gospel with me, I thought one of two things. Number one, either you really didn't believe it, or number two, you didn't care if I went to hell. I could find no other option. And generally speaking, I just thought it was number one. They don't really believe this stuff. But here was someone who did. And so I had actually been trained for this moment. My mom had taught me what to say, and I had received little books that I read as a young child. And so when she said, Nabeel, do you know Jesus? My response was, yes, I do know Jesus. The Quran teaches me that Jesus is virgin born. The Quran teaches me that Jesus is the most miraculous man who ever lived, that he was able to cleanse the lepers and heal the blind and raise the dead. The Quran tells me that Jesus is the Messiah, and I know he will come back at the end of time to initiate latter days. She was shocked. So much so that she didn't know what to say next. So I continued for her. I said, Betsy, I also know that Jesus is not God. And she said, no, Nabeel, that's extremely important. Jesus is God. I said, do you really believe that? And she said, yes. And I said, okay, fine. Betsy, I believe the Gospels have been corrupted. I don't think that you can trust them anymore. But for the sake of this conversation, let's just assume that they are trustworthy. Where does Jesus say he is God? And she thought for a moment, and she said, well, doesn't Jesus say the Father and I are one? I said, yeah, he says that, but that doesn't mean he's God. When I say I'm one with someone, it means we're unified in spirit. And in fact, Jesus makes it clear when he says that he prays for the disciples to be one, just as he is one with the Father. He's praying for them to be unified in spirit in the same way that he's unified in spirit with the Father. Look, Betsy, if you want to know what Jesus says about himself, why not go to the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus says he could do no miracles in Galilee? You're telling me God can't do miracles? Or what about in the Gospel of Luke, where it says that Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature? You're telling me God grows in wisdom? Or how about also in the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus says he doesn't know when the end of times is. Not the angels nor the Son, but only the Father knows. He's saying he doesn't know something that God knows. How could he possibly be God? And with each of these memorized challenges that I gave her, I saw her confidence faltering. And then I gave her my coup de grace. I said, Betsy, if you really want to quote from the Gospel of John, why not quote the verse where Jesus says, the Father is greater than I. I'd believe Jesus if I were you. God is greater than he is. If you want to know the truth about Jesus, ask me about Islam, and I will share Islam with you. And so the one girl who was able to actually step out and try to evangelize, I took her attempt at evangelism and turned it into my own dawah, my own invitation for her to become Muslim. And it was really easy to do this over and over and over again, because I had been trained to do this, and generally speaking, Christians had no idea why they believed what they believed. The sect of Islam that I came from, I don't know if you've seen some of the signs on the roads, the Ahmadi sect there, they've got little signs on the side of the road that say, come out to the barbecue on July 1st. Have you seen these signs? Some of you have. So when you go out there, engage with them, talk with them, they'll have all this stuff memorized. They're training their kids to do to your kids what I used to do to people's kids. So I hope you're ready. What was really fun, if I wanted to mess with a Christian, was to ask them about the Trinity. Then I could have a heyday. I'd just say, hey, what does it mean for God to be a Trinity? And people would say, well, God is three in one. And I'd say, three what in one what? I mean, he's not a shampoo bottle. What does it mean for God to be three in one? And after some, you know, kind of deliberating and thinking, the person would almost invariably say, well, the Trinity is a divine mystery, and I have to believe it by faith. And I would say, time out. The way you're using the word faith is the same way I use the word ignorance. And I want no part of that kind of faith. And this is how, every time I had a conversation with a Christian, it bolstered me in my Islamic faith. It wasn't until I got to the university when that began to change. I joined the public speaking and debate team in my freshman year. And on the very first tournament, I met somebody. I was put in a room to spend the night in a hotel with somebody else who's on the team. And he was reading a Bible. Now, I was shocked. I was flabbergasted to see someone reading a Bible. I figured all Christians knew it wasn't reliable. I'd never seen one reading the Bible anyway, so I thought, this guy, he's reading a Bible, he's especially deluded. Let's fix this. Let's take care of this. And so I said, David, do you realize that that book you're reading is not trustworthy? And David closed the book and said, go on. Which I should have found as a sign that the conversation wasn't going to go my way, but I was too into it. And so I said, David, look, Jesus spoke in Aramaic, and the earliest church was in Jerusalem. They probably spoke Hebrew, but by the time the New Testament was written, it was written in Greek. So you have a translation of a translation of Jesus' words. But then it goes from the Greek New Testament into Latin, and then it lasts 1,000 years in the Latin before it goes to German, and from German it goes to English. So you have a translation of 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 a translation. David, how do we know that something was not lost in translation? How can I know that the Bible is the Word of God? And what I didn't know about David was that 6 years prior, he had been an atheist. He had been raised an atheist his whole life. It wasn't until he saw someone reading the Bible and challenged that person that slowly he entered into a relationship where a year later he gave his life to Christ. And then for the 5 years following, he did nothing except study the Bible and prepare to give answers to people who asked questions. And so the whole day he had been praying to God, God, there's a Muslim on the team. If you can open the door for me to share the gospel. And I just went, hey, how's it going? So David took 1 Peter 3:15 very seriously, to give an answer, to be ready to answer and defend your faith. And so in that moment, he said to me, Nabeel, let me ask you a question. A little while ago, I heard you speaking to your mom on the phone. Was that in English? I said, no. And he said, but when I asked you what you talked about, you told me in English. Was that a bad translation? No. He said, Nabeel, you are multilingual, and what you hear in one language, you can accurately translate into another language. That's exactly what the disciples did. No matter what language Jesus was speaking, he could have been speaking Greek, they took what he said and wrote it in Greek, and of the Greek New Testament, we have over 5,000 ancient manuscripts with which we can be sure of the original message of Jesus. And I looked at him and I said, David, you're making this up. I've spoken to hundreds of Christians. No one said that to me before. He said, you think I'm making this up? I said, yeah, I think you're making this up. He said, well, bring it. I said, it's been brought. Let's go. And so the whole night, we just start arguing about the New Testament and its reliability. We start talking about manuscripts and changes. We start talking about all these things. And what I found in David was someone who actually believed his faith and who was ready to discuss it. And I found someone who reminded me of me. I found a brother who believed and was confident, even though he was a Christian and I was a Muslim, I admired his zeal for God. And so we really got into these conversations. In fact, I found out that he was studying biology and I was studying pre-med, so we decided to sign up for classes together so we could sit in the back and argue. And we would take our discussions back home. I would take him to my mom's house. My mom would make him korma and biryani and paratha. And then we'd go to his dad's house and he'd give me beef jerky. That's fine, we were friends. And so at the end of all this, I realized that David, even though he was a Christian, I knew that David was my best friend and that he would take a bullet for me. Now the thing about the gospel is that it is a message to lay down your life. Now if somebody you don't trust tells you to lay down your life, you're not going to listen to them. But if your best friend who would take a bullet for you is sharing this message with you, you're going to listen. And it's going to have much more of an impact. It took about a year for me to study the origins of the New Testament. And what I found out over the course of that year is truly, there is no model by which the New Testament could have been uniformly and undetectably altered. Just the way it was copied and proliferated and sent out to various corners of Christendom, there's no way anyone could collect them all and alter them and change them at any point in history. So when I came up with this realization, I said, okay, fine, David, and it was a year later. I said, fine, the Bible is reliable. There is no uniform alteration anywhere. It's not possible. But that doesn't mean Christianity is true. You can't jump from the Bible's reliable to Christianity is true. And so we began to discuss, how can we know if Christianity is true? Now, a lot of people just say that if you just share, you know, the gospel in love and let your love be a witness, then someone will come to faith. I think, yeah, of course you need to witness with love, but that's not all there is. If David had just sat there and loved me, I would have never become a Christian. I needed to know that Christianity was true. That there was good reason to believe it. Because there are things in Christianity that are completely contradictory to things that are in Islam. So what is the core of the Christian faith? I found it in Romans chapter 10, verse 9. Some of you might know this verse. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, Jesus is God, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Think about this. Three things. Jesus died on the cross, rose from the dead to prove that he is Lord, that he is God. Interesting. What I realized when I looked at that is that all three of those are historically investigable. Was there a man in the first century? Can we look in the pages of history to see if there was a man in the first century whose name Jesus that died on the cross? Did that man rise from the dead? I mean, you can say, well, that's a miraculous thing. We can't study that historically. Well, we can look at the circumstances surrounding it and see if there's any other explanation. And number three, did that man claim to be God? Now, how is this a case for Christianity? Think about it. When I was in medical school, I was in the psychiatry ward, working in the psychiatry ward. And people would come, and it was pretty common for people to have delusions of grandeur. It was pretty common for people to say something like, I am God. And our response would be, come on in. We got a room for you. Come on in. Because if someone claims to be God, that is pathological. Something is wrong with that person. But if someone then says, no, I'm telling you right now, these people are going to kill me. And to prove what I've been saying to them and what I'm saying to you, I will rise from the dead. Now, if someone claims to be God and then says they're going to prove it by rising from the dead, then we have something to watch and to verify their claim with. So when Jesus came and said that he was God, it was completely understandable that the Jews picked up stones to stone him. But when he said, no, I mean it. Matthew chapter 12, they asked him, why should we believe you? He says, an evil and adulterous generation asks for a sign. No sign shall be given to it except for the sign of Jonah. For just as Jonah was in the belly of the whale for 3 days and three nights, so shall the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth. In other words, he says, you're asking me to prove it? I'll prove it. I'll rise from the dead. Interestingly, this is not just Nabeel telling you this in 2015. This is exactly what the earliest disciples saw. Paul says, if Christ is not risen, our faith is in vain, and we're of all people most to be pitied. The resurrection is the validation of the Christian claim. This is why in Acts chapter 2, when Peter preaches the gospel, what does he end with? This man Jesus rose from the dead. That's the vindication of the Christian claim. So did it happen? One other interesting thing to point out. All three of these things, Jesus claimed to be God, he died on the cross, and he rose from the dead, these three things that we investigated, all three of them are necessary for Christianity to be true, and all three of them are false according to Islam. The Quran says in Surah An-Nisa, verse 157, وَمَا كَتَلُوهُ وَمَا سَلَبُوهُ وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ. He was not killed, nor was he crucified, but so it was made to appear. In other words, in Christianity, you have to believe Jesus died on the cross. In Islam, you cannot believe Jesus died on the cross. Look, let's dispense with these notions that all religions are true because they contradict each other. They can't both be right. Jesus did die on the cross, Christianity. Jesus didn't, Islam. There's no overlap. They're not both right. Did Jesus claim to be God? That was extremely important to me because the Quran denies repeatedly that Jesus claimed to be God. In fact, chapter 5 of the Quran, verses 72 and 73 say, if you believe Jesus is God, you will go to hell. So on one hand, you have to believe Jesus is God to be saved. On the other hand, if you believe Jesus is God, you will not be saved. So each of these points, then, doesn't just fulfill the definition of Christianity, but it also counters Islam. So I spent 3 years studying these issues. I had to learn how to study history. I was studying medicine. I was studying clinical science. But in order to answer these questions, I had to learn the principles of historical investigation. And over years, I came to the realization that there simply is no historical doubt that Jesus died on the cross. There is none. Even atheists and agnostic scholars conclude that the best evidenced fact in Jesus' life is that he died on the cross. In fact, one Muslim scholar, Reza Aslan, in his book Zealot, even as a Muslim, has to conclude the Quran is wrong. Jesus died. He says that as a Muslim. When you study whether Jesus rose from the dead or not, again, historically, take a look at it through a historian's lens. When you take a look at the evidence surrounding Jesus' death, you cannot conclude anything with any degree of certainty beyond the conclusion that Jesus rose from the dead. In other words, you can say, look, I don't know what happened. You can retreat into agnosticism and say, look, I see the things that happened around Jesus' death. I don't know how to explain it. Fine, fair enough. But if you conclude anything, the best explanation by far is that Jesus rose from the dead. Historically, I saw this as a Muslim. But the one that mattered the most, did Jesus claim to be God? I came away after studying the Gospels, realizing, at first I looked at the Gospel of John. In the beginning of the Gospel of John, it says, En arche ein halagas, kai halagas ein prastan theon, kai theon theos ein halagas, and the word was God. John chapter 1 starts off saying it very clearly, Jesus is God. John 20:28, Thomas says to Jesus, Kurios mu kai theos mu, my Lord and my God. Gospel of John, very clear, Jesus is God, no way around it. So what did I do? I said, well, John's gospel came 60 years after Jesus died. We can't trust that gospel. Let's go to the first gospel, Mark's gospel. And when I investigated Mark's gospel carefully, what I found was that the whole gospel works as a crescendo to Mark 14:62, where basically Jesus says, I am the God of Moses, I am the God of Daniel, and I am the God of David. We miss it because we don't read it the way the early Jews would have read it. But when we understand our Bible, we see Jesus claims to be God 3 times in 3 ways in Mark 14:62. And that's why they tear their clothes and say, you have heard the blasphemy. Crucify him. All 4 Gospels proclaim Jesus said he was God. Even before that, Paul says in Philippians chapter 2 that he was in very nature God. And we take, at the end of Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 11, we see that Yahweh is removed from the paragraph and Jesus is inserted in his place. Jesus is Yahweh. From the beginning of Christian history, Jesus has been God. So when I see this as a Muslim, I come to the conclusion that the case for Christianity is actually very strong. Very strong. David and I remember we were driving back. We were very manly men. We had gone to a smoothie bar. And we were driving back from the smoothie bar, and David says to me, Nabeel, you've been studying Christianity on a scale of 1 to 100, 1 being not at all true, 100 being quite likely true. Where do you put the case for Christianity? And I said, death of Christ on a cross, 99%. Jesus claimed to be God, 90%. Jesus rose from the dead, 90%. I put the whole thing at between 80 and 85%. And David says, after spluttering his smoothie, he said, Nabeel, then why don't you become a Christian? And I said, because Islam is 100% true. Allahu Akbar. Islam's true. And he says, but Nabeel, you haven't investigated it with the same level of critical scrutiny that you did Christianity. And I said, David, look, I've known about Islam since childhood. I know it is strong. And he said, well, just try it. Make a case for Islam and defend that and see what you think. I said, sure, no problem. I know Islam will vindicate itself. He said, all right, good. What's the case for Islam then? I said, well, it has to come from the Shahada. La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. So Muhammad is a prophet of God. If that's true, Islam is true. Or the Quran is the word of God. If that is true, Islam is true. And he says, okay, fine, build your case. Now what I want to share with you, if you're talking with an atheist or an agnostic or a Buddhist or a Mormon or whoever you're talking to, when you present Christianity to them, and that's it, you just look at Christianity, people can poke holes all day. People can poke holes into anything all day. But when you want to really get to the truth of the matter, as Oz Guinness says, contrast is the mother of clarity. Bring both of the things to the fore and compare them together. And look, when I compared the strength of the Christian case for the strength of the Islamic case, that's when I realized that there was no comparison. Because, remember, up until that point, I had thrown out the Gospel of John because it was written 60 years, supposedly. I don't think anymore. But at the time, I thought, 60 years after Jesus? That's pretty late. I can't trust it. The earliest source we have on Muhammad's life comes 150 years after he dies. And of that source, we actually don't have any records. Somebody saved portions of that, and he said the reason he didn't save all of it was because it was full of fabrications. That's what the foundation of Islam is like. It's not till 200 and 250 years later that we start getting the hadith that Muslims find reliable. So the comparison, all of a sudden, it made things clear. And now the reason why I followed Muhammad my whole life was because I had been taught that Muhammad was the greatest man who ever lived. He was the greatest father. He was the greatest husband. He was the greatest statesman, the greatest diplomat, the greatest general. He took care of orphans and widows and the poor. It didn't matter what epithet you gave him, he deserved it. He was that great. And with such a man, I could say he is the chief of the prophets. But when I started looking at the pages of history to learn not what my parents told me, not what my imam told me, but what the actual records say about Muhammad's life, I went from shocked to appalled to realizing that Muhammad's life was unconscionable. There were things in the pages of history that if anyone did those, far from calling him a prophet, I would run the other direction. And that was the truth. Now, I could just turn my mind off and say, I'm going to follow him anyway. But that's what I always accused Christians of doing. I wanted to follow the truth. So then I hinged my hopes on the Quran, and I said, the Quran contains scientific truths that Muhammad could never have known. The Quran has prophecies. The Quran has mathematical patterns. The Quran has miraculous indications that it is from God. It cannot be copied by anyone. And the most important argument for me, though, was that the Quran had never been changed. Or so I thought. And when I started studying the pages of Islamic history, I found out that the Quran had constantly evolved. At one point, even one of the caliphs took all the copies of the Quran and burned them and wrote an official version. And Muslims know this. It's in Sahih Bukhari, book 6, volume 6, book 61, number 509, 510. You can read it for yourself. When I saw this, I was completely decimated. Everything I had believed from childhood had been shaken and challenged, and I didn't know what to do with myself. I went from mosque to mosque to mosque, asking imams to help me answer some of these issues. I was praying day in, day out, asking Allah to show me who he was. And that's where the title of my book comes from, Seeking Allah, Finding Jesus. I sought Allah every single day, in prayer, in tears. Allah, if you are the God of Islam, show me. But if you are Jesus, I will follow you, no matter the cost. I said that kind of brazenly. If I had known back then what I know now, I might have been a bit more careful. Now, the reason why someone doesn't just convert from intellectual evidence, and it usually doesn't happen that way, is because their life is more than just intellect. There's social consequences. There's emotional consequences to all these kinds of things. And so I knew if I became a Christian, that would mean that I would have to take everything my mom had done in her whole life. I mean, it's an honor-shame society, right? So she's built her reputation on the fact that she's a good Muslim and she's raised good Muslim kids, and I'm her only son. Look at her son. Look at how good a Muslim he is. If I become a Christian, not only am I cutting myself off from the Islamic community, I'm taking everything my mom has ever done and throwing it in her face. Can I do that? And let's just say I can. Traditionally, In Islam, all four major schools of Sunni thought and all three major branches of Shia thought say if you leave Islam under some circumstance or another, you can be killed for it. Am I willing to potentially give up the physical life as well as my social life? And let's not forget Surah Al-Ma'idah, verses 72 and 73. If I'm wrong, and I say Jesus is God, but Islam is true, I'll be going to hell. Can I give up literally everything based on the case for Islam versus Christianity? I asked God to start showing me whether what I had found was true. And this is where I put all the academic stuff aside, and I just sought God. Now, I don't know if you know this, but Muslims generally ask Allah to reveal His guidance through dreams. Now, Christians, I don't think you realize how good you've got it. You don't have to follow 613 mitzvot like in the Old Testament. You don't have to do a ton of sacrifices and go to the Holy of Holies. The veil has been torn, and you commune with God. But most people don't. And in Islam, it wasn't the notion that we can just commune with God and He will, you know, telegraphically give me the answer or anything like that. It's through dreams and visions. That's what Muslims expect. In fact, we had a special prayer called Salat Istikhara that was designed to ask Allah to give us guidance through a dream or a vision. When my sister got married, she asked for a dream. When my father chose a job, he asked for a dream. And I wish I could tell you the stories. They're in my book. And by the way, I can say that because the books that they're selling, I don't get a dollar from them. So go buy them. All these details are in there. I had seen prophetic dreams come true in my family time and time and time again. There was no doubt that we ought to turn to God for guidance through dreams and visions. So I did. I don't have time to share the details, but God gave me a vision in three dreams that each showed me Christianity was true. Now to accept it, though, I couldn't just do that. It took time. And I was driving to school. By the way, I started this all my freshman year at the beginning, the first few weeks of my freshman year of college. At this point, I'm now in my second year of grad school. So this took a long time. And as I'm driving to school that day, just remember crying, saying to God, God, I know what I need to do, but just give me time to mourn. Just give me time to mourn the loss. Instead of going to school that day, I went back to my apartment, and I was a mess. And so I just said, God, comfort me. And I just pulled out the Quran and the Bible, and I put them both in front of me, and I said, God, comfort me. And I turned to the Quran first. Now, every time I had used Quranic verses or memorized Quranic prayers, it was because someone had told me to do that. This was my first time opening the Quran to look for myself, to find something. And I looked for comfort. And what I found was not a single verse in the Quran is designed to comfort a hurting man. Not one. And so I put the Quran away. I said, this doesn't apply to my life. And I opened up the Bible. Again, I had read the Bible to try to tear it apart. I had never actually read it to try to go for guidance. And so I said, God, can you guide me? I didn't know where to start. I knew Christians read the New Testament. So I flipped open Matthew chapter 1. Saw a bunch of genealogies, so I skipped them. Hey, I had an excuse. I was a Muslim. You guys have no excuse. Skip the genealogies. Didn't take me long to get to Matthew chapter 5. And it says in Matthew 5, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Do you realize what kind of message that is? I mean, I think to myself in that moment, God, why are you going to bless those who mourn? What have they done to deserve your blessing? But in that moment, I knew that this was a divine message. It was as if God had written this verse for me. I mean, you guys can read it, that's fine, but that verse is mine. That's how I felt. And I start reading more, and it says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Wait a minute, God, why would you bless me for hungering and thirsting for righteousness? I do. I wish I were righteous. I keep failing, but you're going to bless me anyway? And all of a sudden, I was encountering in the pages of the New Testament a God who loves us despite our failures. And this, to me, was mind-blowing. I just couldn't get enough of it. I started reading, David had given me a study Bible, so I started reading every single footnote. I didn't want to miss anything. And I would be praying, and I'd say, God, how can I know that you hear me? And I'd read the footnotes. If you want to know, God can hear you. Go to 1 John 5. Sweet. fire fall in this church, I think we have to evacuate, do we? I think we have to go. I love you guys. Thanks.